Welcome everybody to the second in a series of conversations around the rise of bots, automation, the future of contact centers and customer experience. Once again, I'm joined by someone I've known for years, Simon Shaw. So Simon, good to meet you. And what are you up to right now?
Yeah, hi Paul, very good to see you again. Yeah, it's been a number of years since we worked together. So I'm working with IBM now in our IX division, which is all about digital experiences. And I lead our customer service and contact center practice across EMEA. So heavily involved in lots of organizations who are doing service transformation when it comes to contact centers and customer experience. But what are you up to at the moment, Paul?
So thanks, Simon. So been with Vonage. It was New Voice Media until acquired by Vonage for 12 years. And Vonage is a business involved in contact centers, AI, messaging, APIs, and unified communications. And I look after business in continental Europe, specifically for enterprise organizations, which means I get to work with a ton of companies looking at their future for specifically, in this case, contact centers. On the previous video, we kind of looked at the landscape of bots and automation and some of the goals and perhaps some of the, let's just say, incorrect goals or poorly defined goals, and particularly organizations looking to the use of bots and automation to save money, to deflect calls, perhaps, rather than to improve the experience. Now, in this session, we're going to talk about, in fact, the opposite. So how should you be thinking about the use of bots? When is it appropriate? And what's a good design? So what's the first message you'd like to provide?
Well, I mean, one of the things we at IBM talk about is we actually try and avoid the use of the word bot, because I think there is that connotation. So try and sort of use the word virtual assistant. And that leads into the sort of view of the world of really, from a service design perspective, looking at them as concierge types of tools. So whether that's concierges for the customer or actually even for the agent, because I think, again, maybe don't people realize that there is maybe just as much, if not more, effectiveness of some of this technology on the agent side than there is on the pure customer side. So I think, you know, if the starting point is, okay, if we want to provide some form of virtual agent concierge type of service, where is it best placed in the journey to undertake, and what's the value that it can bring? So like a lot of activities, I think you know, you will always as an organization have to think about what's the value it's going to bring to me as an organization or my customer base, and work from there. I mean, I've got a recent experience myself, actually, where I phoned a major DIY chain because I was chasing up an order. And interesting enough, they had a bot at the front end. It recognized I was calling from a mobile. It also said they were very busy at the moment, and whether, you know, would I like either a callback or actually to be sent a link to a live chat, because the live chat team was available. And I opted for live chat, and they, you know, within a couple of seconds, up popped a link on my mobile. And, you know, that sort of really use of a bot in a very targeted way for a very specific reason actually really enhanced that experience for me personally. But what about you? What are your thoughts as to sort of starting points when it comes to this sort of technology?
Actually, I want to pick up on something you said, because I love the phrase concierge, or a personal assistant, a personal digital assistant. And I've just actually rewatched Blade Runner 2049, is it, or something like that, where maybe we won't go to all of it, but he has his own personal assistant, a virtual assistant. Obviously, it's a hologram. Maybe we're not there yet. But I love the thought of interacting with a company. And when I interact, I get my own virtual assistant, even someone who's named and who knows my name, who I could actually have a conversation with. And everyone's got a different one. And do you think, are we there yet with such assistants learning and adapting to me, to my preferences, and how would that assistant have knowledge of me and my choices and my products? Do you think, are we there?
I think principally we probably, if you think about it, the most organizations probably have enough data about you if you're a known customer of theirs or a regular customer of theirs to be able to start thinking about it. And I suppose, I mean, we've all talked about personalization, whether it's from a marketing perspective or within a contact center environment for a long time, and the whole customer 360 principle. And if you take that customer 360 principle, that data is all available for a virtual agent, concierge, digital assistant to be starting to provide personal recommendations. And I suppose if you think about where we're driving, certainly from an agent side, and maybe thinking about an agent personal assistant and next best actions and guided workflows and things like that, that are very much sort of in the technology space now, in the sort of the big CRM platforms and case management tools, we probably are there from a point of view of the technical capability. Where we're, whether we're there yet from an organizational maturity perspective is another matter, because we already find, even with the sort of fairly basic virtual assistant deployments, that there's a lot of organizations that don't realize they have to treat them like human agents still. It's not a set and forget type of thing. You know, just because you bought a virtual assistant technology, you still have to train it. You have to do QA on it. You have to sort of give it feedback as such, really. You know, it's not a magic wand where it does everything itself. So I think, yes, I think from a pure technology perspective, we're not far away from it. And it's just a case of how best to use it and where best to use it. I mean, what are your thoughts from a point of view of whether you feel we're close enough to it yet or not?
Yeah, so I think, you know, technology that's available right now, whether you, whoever you get it from, but certainly with Vonage, we're talking about the, let's imagine a conversation just goes like this. So you ring up, there might be a queue, maybe it's a bit busy. And traditionally, what are you going to get? You go through an IVR. So for people who don't know, that's, yeah, a voice and a pre-recorded announcement saying for this option, press one, and that option, press two. And you do a few of them, and then you sit in a queue with music. And then what's going to happen is you're going to get to an agent eventually who then has to do something called ID and V, which is classically called identification and verification. So we're all familiar with that. The agent spends a minute or two saying, Paul, what's your address? What's your date of birth? Can I get digits 3 and 8 from your magic number, which I can't remember? And yeah, you know, stuff like that. But how about a bot saving everybody time by a bot being able to do that, or a virtual assistant, as you've correctly said? I'm thinking more about technology here as a bot. I did my first degree in artificial intelligence, and that was a long time ago, my project. But anyway, how about the digital assistant says something like, thanks for calling. It's going to be, you know, a short wait before we get you to the human agent. So while you're waiting, we'd love to take some details from you, because it's going to save you time when you get to the human agent. Are you happy? And if you are happy to do that, just say yes or press one. Now, for me, you know, in terms of best practice, I'm being given a choice. And I think that's where a lot of implementations today fall down. There's no choice. And I can't get out of this. Sometimes, well, it's not quite the loop of death, but I can't get out of a loop because it doesn't understand me. But if I was happy to do that, I want to say sure or yes. And then it says something like, okay, speak or enter, you know, your account number. And then using two-factor authentication, because I think security, and this is maybe some another topic we should pick up, but security is where, yeah, is the topic right now, of course. So maybe the system then sends a number to my mobile phone, which it's got on record, but I didn't just give it then. So it's secure and it's two-factor. And only if I'm holding my mobile does the number come up and I can enter it back to the digital assistant, pass validation through two-factor. And then I perhaps not only get music, but I get targeted messaging because it knows who I am and it's validated who I am. So it knows I have this car, not that one. Or I have a gas boiler, not an oil boiler, or whatever it might be, and plays relevant messages. When I get to the agent, maybe the agent gets the screen pop in the CRM that they're on, and it says passed validation. And the agent can greet me by name. Wouldn't that be fabulous? And I don't know, do you experience choice when you are presented with a digital assistant at the start of a call?
Yeah, I think, I mean, where I've seen it done well, absolutely. And it, you know, that's why I think I like the term concierge, because I think a bit like especially banks now, when you go into a bank branch, there's a lot of the time you have that sort of meter and greeter with an iPad at the front before you sort of go and hit the counters, and they potentially triage or guide you to realizing you could do something, or they offer to do something on your behalf to save you queuing up. So I think, you know, that where it's done well, absolutely. But this, you know, coming all the way back to the beginning point, it needs to be part of a designed journey and understanding where the right moments are for bots to interact as such, really, rather than it being sort of, we have a piece of technology, let's insert it into the process because we've purchased it as such, really. So I think that's really important. And I think, you know, the other thing is, and maybe this is, again, another discussion point that we can have on a later date, but being able to have the virtual assistants to identify when you're hitting frustration points and being able to recognize that you need to escalate or move it from maybe the automation path into a human path is really key and really important. So that starts bringing in that sort of sentiment analysis and tone analysis and technologies like that, which I think, you know, would be fantastic to discuss on another session with you, Paul.
No, I think that's, Simon, that's a natural end to that conversation because we have limited time. But let's do it. Let's get on and talk next about sentiment analysis, emotional content, and where that technology is at today. Simon, great to talk to you again.
You too, Paul.